with us, who's en route to doing a evening lecture at Cal State LA, Professor Komozi Woodard. Komozi Woodard has been a seminal figure in the genre faculty grab this black scholar here. In the area of interest to historians and scholars in a lot of disciplines known as Black Power Studies. And this edition of the Black Scholar talks about the whole wave of intellectual work that's examining the Black Nationalist resurgence of the 1960s. And Professor Woodard's book came out, actually I read your work first in his dissertation form in the 90s when I was a graduate student, and thinking about how am I going to pull off writing this book on the US organization. So Professor Woodard made my job easier and opened up a new dialogue on this area called cultural nationalism. So his work has been stated by one scholar who's sort of written on Black Power Studies, Peniel Joseph, as singularly the best book on the Black Power movement. And I certainly concur. It's a very rich text, and he brings with us a vast knowledge of the movement. So just want to have an opportunity for him to talk about his work and for us to dialogue about some of these issues.
Well, let me, I'm Komozi, but I don't think I've met you before. And what are you studying?
I'm history and English. I'm starting my thesis on the Black Power.
I know, although I never have.
Yeah, I like to speak to you. So, but let me tell you a little bit about how this book came about, and that would be one way to launch into this. How should I be? You know, what basically happened is I was at a memorial in the 1980s, mid-1980s. A man named Harold Wilson was murdered in the early 1980s, and he was a childhood friend of Mitty Barak or Leroy Jones. They grew up together, right? And they built the Black Power Movement in Newark together. So Harold Wilson, or Emisani as we used to call him, that was his African name, Emisani, I worked in the movement with him. He was murdered in the middle of some work we were doing. It wasn't a political murder, he was murdered, street crime. But he always, he was the kind of person who would do a lot of work in the community. So even after the Black Power Movement was gone, he continued doing that work. And he was also a merchant himself. He owned a number of stores and things like that. So he forced the businesses on Springfield Avenue to set up a youth center. And once Emisani called us, we couldn't say no. So come down, you're going to have karate classes, you're going to have poetry classes, you want to do political education. So we were all there. And he would operate that, and his wife would operate the store. And then he closed the center down and go close out the store with her so she wouldn't be robbed. And one night he went there and somebody pulled a gun on his wife. Emisani had a reputation in the street as a man who never backed down. So the guy shot him and killed him. So we had a memorial for Emisani. And at that memorial, one of the young people, Larry Ham, who went to Princeton University and things like that, is a product of our movement, gave the a talk about him and basically ran him down at his own memorial. He was always late to meetings, he was illiterate, and unconsciously or consciously he was comparing him negatively to Mitty Barak or Leroy Jones, the writer, the genius, and stuff like that. So I wasn't on the list, you know, to speak, but I had to get up there and say something. Barak wasn't there to vouch for his friend, so I got up there and off the top of my head said, look, you know, a lot of people who made history didn't write books. I don't think Jesus wrote a book, right? So, you know, a lot of people throughout history have made history, but they're not necessarily literate. And we need a new kind of history that captures people who don't necessarily, they're not going to write their own book, right, and stuff like that, right? So after I gave that talk, a sister named Takalifu came to me, was one of our tenant leaders back in the old days, and we had worked together, and since then she'd become a school teacher. She said, you need to write our history. And I hadn't really, you know, prepared for that. And I said, whoa, you know, because I was running a journalism program called Children's Express, but we were interviewing people. It was oral journalism. So we got the idea, okay, all these people that we want to write about, who are the bulk of the movement, are not going to write their memoirs. So maybe if I get my kids together, we'll go around and we'll interview these people who were off stories. So I formed a group of kids, 13 years old was the oldest. And we went to start at the senior citizens home where many of the movement veterans were already there. We've actually built, let me step back just a minute. We built a 100-acre development in the Black Power Movement. And the tallest building was a senior citizens building, and many of the movement veterans moved into that building in their old age. So we went there, and they hadn't finished building this neighborhood at that time. Now it's the whole neighborhood's built. So we literally had to walk through the rubble of Newark Central Ward. If you've never been to Newark, it's one of the worst ghettos in America, okay?
Yeah,
so you walk through the rubble. My kids are walking through the rubble to get to the senior citizens building, to get to this tower that was designed by the community. And they then went in there, and they were taken in by this community of senior citizens who had been in the movement. And I remember Vanessa Whitehead, who is now a graduated engineering degree from Cornell University. Well, she was from the worst housing project in Newark at the time. And when she walked out of that senior citizens thing after those interviews, she was walking with her head up high, walking through that rubble. So we got back to the office. I said, Vanessa, what do you think about the interview? She said, you know, I didn't know this neighborhood had a history. So we proceeded. We did, and we must have done about 50 interviews locally, nationally. We came, James Farmer and Dorothy Cotton would come through town. We interviewed everybody who came through town. We would do these interviews. And you know, so that was basically the project, how it began. Then when I went to graduate school, I found out that, wow, you know, there wasn't much written on this period. And what had been written basically wrote these people out of history. I mean, even Claiborne Carson's book that I love on SNCC basically tells people the movement was over in 1968. And that the main reason it was over is because the culprit was Black Power. Black Power comes in, it's nothing about anger and, all this negative stuff. And it didn't really build anything like the Southern movement did, right? And I said, well, what, you know, was I there? You know, I was kind of around for this period, and people like Imasani and all those people, their lives were worth nothing if we let that stand. So I looked at those interviews, and I made that my dissertation. I took those 50 interviews, added more to it, and made that into my dissertation, and then after thinking about it some more, made it into a book, which you see here, Nation Within a Nation. So it all starts with Harold Wilson. So more recently, I've been, let me tell you a little bit about Baraka, since you, some of you are studying the black arts, and then I'll go back into some of the new work I'm working on. Baraka is, let me read this part here, this will be better, because, you write things to get things right. Sometimes you should respect your own worker. Okay, Amedi Baraka Leroy Jones, the author of more than 20 plays, 3 jazz operas, 7 books of nonfiction. I think that's still the case. More than 1 novel now. He's published something since I wrote this. And more than 12 volumes of poetry. He's best known as a major cultural leader, one of the African-American writers who galvanized the second black renaissance, the black arts movement in the 1960s, and made an indelible contribution on modern African-American culture and consciousness. According to a number of authorities, contemporary American artist Baraka must be ranked with the likes of John Coltrane, Ralph Ellison, Norman Mailer, Toni Morrison, and people like that. As the father of the Black Arts Movement, Baraka almost single-handedly changed the nature and the form of post-World War II African-American literature. So he's done a lot. Biographer Arnold Rampersad places Baraka alongside Phyllis Wheatley, Frederick Douglass, Paul Laurence Dunbar, Langston Hughes, Zora Neale Hurston, Richard Wright, and Ralph Ellison. one of the 8 figures who have significantly affected the course of African American literary culture. And Maya Angelou's, who's no lightweight here, she argues that Baraka is the most, the greatest living poet. So that says a lot. Particularly in the middle of this, we gave a conference in February about Baraka's Blues People, a book on, you know, African American music, because and the turmoil that's been going on, Baraka, you know, he's in the controversy about being named the Poet Laureate of New Jersey, and they said he was an anti-Semite, and on and on. And basically, the controversy got so bad, they said he wasn't an artist. So I thought we should give a conference that's not always focused on Baraka's politics. But let's establish what Baraka was first. He was an artist, okay? And what was so 40 years later, my kids, we read Blues People, my kids said, well, what have you written since this book, and what do people think about this afterwards? So we brought experts from all over the country, to see, you know, including Professor Brown, right, to a 2-day symposium to talk about his work. And it was, you know, it was not an uncritical conference, but some of the major scholars on jazz, what's it, John Schwed, who wrote the So What, Miles Davis biography, and Space is the Place with Sun Ra, said there's something that's always bothered, you know, and Sweat is like old now, he's about to be retired, he's an honorary professor at Yale, University of Columbia, the whole deal, right? He said, you know, and everybody remembered when they read Blues People. Everybody remembered where they were, where they were sitting, what the moment. Most people said they read it in one sitting. But he was up at the North Pole at the time when he read Blues People. And he said, there's something that's been bothering about this book ever since I read it, and I finally figured out what it was. I didn't write that book. He wrote it first, right? Because Baraka wrote this book, you know, as a scholar. So it was an anthropology. He didn't have the authority to write a book like Blues People. Blues and black people's music didn't have the status of being an academic subject at the time. Right? So although people might have been interested in the music and stuff like that, Baraka single-handedly wrote the book, didn't care what people thought, and wrote it and raised it up to a level that now you have a chair professor at Harvard University, and the chair, the Quincy Jones chair who was there and stuff like that. All of them thanked Baraka for that work. So I thought that, you know, so first of all, Baraka is an artist, but he's unique as an artist, right? Because he's writing in all these different genres. Right? He won the Obie Award for the Dutchman, the play, and stuff like that. So he's writing on music, he's writing poetry, he's writing plays, he's editing everybody else's poetry even before he's well established. But then the other thing that makes him really singular is that he leads a cultural movement, the Black Arts Movement. He's one of the many leaders of that movement. And he turns into politics, goes into the political field. So the only person I can readily compare him to in the U.S. who made a similar turn would be Paul Robeson, right? Paul Robeson would be your other, we know what happened to Paul Robeson once he got in politics, right? So similar kind of thing has happened to Baraka. You really, it's a no-no. Although if you look around the world, most cultural people are involved in politics as well. It's the U.S. has created a fiction. There's a guy, I'm gonna forget his name, Bruce Franklin, who writes prison literature. And he came and lectured in my class a few years ago. And that's one of those things when you invite somebody to speak and they outdo you. I mean, I wish I'd given that lecture. But basically, he did this in my class. But what he laid out was, hey, most writers that you read were in the joint. Whether you're reading Dostoevsky or all the Western writers, up to the 20th century, they're all going to jail for writing, right? So in many ways, Baraka is part of that international trend of writers who are committed. They're not just writing for writing. I mean, Alexander Dumas, you could do the roll call. All of them were in the jail, or they went to exile, so they wouldn't go to jail, right? But you get in trouble for writing down what you see, what you feel, what you think in this world. That's the way it is. And so Baraka fits in with that. But in the United States, it looks like it's very weird. So that's how you can create the question that sounds authoritative. Why is this writer involved in politics? When most writers have been involved in politics, and that's what's going on here. As a matter of fact, it's no accident. Dumas, you read about people in dungeons all the time and stuff like that. He knew it well.
Right.
He knew it well. So he does that, and what he goes into politics, and he does not only the Black Rights Movement in Harlem in particular, he did the Black... what happens is Baraka is involved with... he goes to Cuba on a delegation of Black writers in 1960, first celebration of the Cuban Revolution. He comes back, and then he gets involved in a demonstration against the murder of Patrice Lumumba at the United Nations. They call it the United Nations riot, but it was a demonstration. And then he stays in the village for a long time, but he's associated with Malcolm X, trying to learn from Malcolm X. There's a famous meeting, an important meeting most people don't know about, January 1965, between Malcolm X, Baraka, and Mohamed Babu, who was the leader of the Zanzibar Revolution in East Africa, right? They meet from 8 o'clock at night till 8 the next morning at the Teresa Hotel about what should be the strategy of Black liberation worldwide. This is a very difficult meeting to find out what happened. Malcolm, of course, can't tell us. I tried to get Mohamed Babu before he died to go on the record. The most he would say about it, 25 years after that meeting, it was a conference on Malcolm X and young people. And so I called him out since he wasn't going to talk about it. I think he was afraid. You know, he had been exiled from Tanzania, where he had been in government there. He was living in London. I think the CIA and people like that were probably after him, so he didn't want to be too outspoken on what anti-imperialist theory and work they were coming up with in this meeting. But, and for the first time, I asked Baraka, who always was forthcoming when I interviewed him, I said, Baraka, what happened in that meeting with you and Malcolm X and Babu? Y'all met 12 hours all night long. This is important. And Baraka asked me, what did Babu say, I should say? So I said, I got a story here. You know, I'm going to have to check. They must have really been talking about something here. So I called Babu out, and Babu said, and I said, you have to tell us something. If Malcolm, this happened 25 years ago, these people want to know what Malcolm X thought just before he died. Right? And he said, the only thing I can tell you is that the debate was whether our struggle was primarily a racial struggle or a class struggle. And I think you'll see when you look at Malcolm's speeches later that month and the next month, that's what he's talking about. Whether that Oxford speech and stuff like that, that he's trying to put the proportions together of the race and the class struggle as a global struggle against racism, right? But Baraka, because of that, feels, and then Malcolm X is assassinated about 30 days later. So within about a week of a Malcolm's assassination, well, first of all, Baraka writes this, it's basically two documents coming out of Malcolm's assassination that everyone thinks about. One is Ozzie Davis's eulogy, which is in the back of the book, Autobiography of Malcolm X, right? And Baraka's poem for Malcolm X, right? And stuff like that, where he writes this very emotional kind of call to war that we have to do with this Black liberation. Well, he doesn't just write a poem. He moves, he leaves his wife in the village, he's married to a white woman, and he goes to Harlem and he starts this theater movement, Black Arts Repertory Theater School, or theater school, BARTS, that's what it is. And that's like the beginning of March 1965, so right after Malcolm's assassination. And they do a lot of great work. He's working with Harold Cruz, who's going to be very important, right? Wrote Crisis of the Negro Intellectual. He's worked with Larry Neal. He's worked with Sonia Sanchez. Worked with just a whole host of... Lou Gossett is teaching acting courses there. It's really an interesting image of the Black arts, because there's a painting class, there's a filmmaking classes, there are writing classes, dance. Just about all the arts are being represented there, right? And they educate 400 kids in one summer. That's summer of 65. 400 high school kids come through here. And then it cracks up. There's all kinds of violence and shootout, and Barack abandons the project by the end of the year and goes back to his hometown, Newark, New Jersey, basically in retreat. Right? Larry Neal's shot in the streets in the middle of this. It was a real mess. And Barack thinks his life is a failure. So he goes home, and he finds that, wow, okay, number one, people listened to what he was saying. This black arts movement is spreading throughout the country. There's something happening on the West Coast, something happening in Chicago, something's happening down south, people are writing journals. It didn't die, even though he messed up. Number two, in his hometown, there's a little black arts movement already. And his future wife ends up being in those, she's an actress in those circles and things like that. Let me read this stuff. So basically what happens, one of the people he meets coming back home is his childhood friend, Emma Sani. Harold Wilson is a merchant. His father was a grocer. His father was killed by the police in Newark. He's a community organizer. He's active in everything from the NAACP to the Nation of Islam. Matter of fact, his other name is Hassan. Okay? And he is this big community person. And when Baraka is beaten up during the Newark uprising in 1967, Baraka is one of the worst people being beaten up in that case there, Harrelson comes to his defense. And a whole organization from that defense committee to get Barack out of jail and deal with this whole beating, a new organization arises. Emma Sani comes up with the idea of a new kind of organization. And let me see if I can capture that. Okay, and this new organization, I'm going to call it, it's got two names. One is the United Brothers, which speaks to the kind of kinship thing. The weird thing about the United Brothers is there were a lot of sisters in the United Brothers, okay? So even though it says United Brothers, don't go for the ghost there. It's a lot of sisters, but they thought the brotherhood, it was a many groups like the African Blood Brotherhood, many of the African American radical groups speaks to a kinship. So think about the brother as more like a brotherhood. It's the kind of organization it is. It's a kinship. Then Marlana Karenga from the West Coast, the leader of US organization, comes out and looks at it and says, wow, you know, this name, the United Brothers, for other people sounds too sinister. So let's change your name to the Committee for Unified Newark. It's about unity on a broad scale. And it sounds, when you go into politics, it's going to sound better. So CFUN is Committee for Unified Newark. That's the other. So it's a United Brothers and CFUN is this political group. That's how that comes about. CFUN was an organization of organizers, right? These people were already, it's an organization. They sat people in rooms like this. One person, you're a neighborhood organizer. You're working with tenants. You're working for welfare mothers. You're doing police brutality. Everybody has a specialty. They come together and form a circle. They're an organization of organizers. Everybody, it's like SNCC in a sense, right? Everybody's an organizer. And so they're feeding. When they have a meeting here, and they're saying, what are we going to do about Newark? This is a whole new level of thinking about politics. They're bringing the welfare rights, the tenant thing, and making that part of a political agenda to run candidates, which it really wasn't, you know, if you look at most politics, it's not about issues, those issues. That's not the stuff you run politics on. So this is one of the ways they attracted people. They had leaders representing segments of the tenants, social clubs, teachers, neighborhood youth, mothers, community organizations, veterans, reform-oriented police caucus. Emerson's brother was a cop. And they formed the Bronze Shield. So the Bronze Shield, that caucus against racism and police department, was a part of the group from the beginning. Low-level civil servants, militant welfare mothers, high school students, women's clubs, progressive welfare, and housing authorities, social workers were part of the group. Families of inmates, so the prison reform becomes part of the agenda, right? relatives of victims of police brutality, musicians, dancers, poets, and actors. And so what happens after a while, they're sitting in a circle, and okay, you're doing welfare, we've got this big case. This woman bought, she's a welfare mother, she bought a living room set with all her money. She takes it home, and within a day, the stuff is breaking. She goes back to the guy, he won't give her money back, and stuff like that. Well, the community organized, okay, we'll do a protest. We do a protest for weeks. The guy doesn't relent. So artists say, hey, wait a minute. Let's do something different. You know, we're doing skits in the street and stuff like that. Let's invent an anti-commercial. Right? So they've already taken over the radio station and demanded that there's going to be a day of community radio programming. That's in the background. So yeah, they got a program, and they come on, and they start doing everyday anti-commercials. And there's a skit on the radio about this man's, the name of his store, this woman who buys the furniture, and the children sit down on it, and this thing breaks, right? So he's getting hit with that for about 2 weeks, and he decides, out of the goodness of his heart, to give her a new set of furniture and stuff like that, right? But it was that kind of organization where you'd sit around, and all the different kind of skills you had, the poets, the musicians, everyone would put their thing and say, okay, let's play it this way, we'll publicize it this way, we'll mobilize the community this way, and we'll dramatize the issue that way. In many ways, you probably know, Barack is behind the election of the first black mayor in Newark in the end of the whole thing. He built numerous institutions from the African Free School to Cowie the Towers, which I worked on building housing. This whole neighborhood I told you about, that 100-acre, was redeveloped. So a lot of stuff. We could go on and on. And I lost my train of thought as I was telling you that, too. But one of the things I think is interesting about his approach to politics was, and I had his notes on a number of things, Baraka would think about many things in terms of literature and plays. And I'll say it this way. We were doing a public hearing on racism, right? And it was going to be televised and stuff like that. So Baraka gives me the notes of how to line up the witnesses, right? And it's a play. And so he gives me a script. And but these are real people, right? But he says if these people are interrogated in this order, then the public will understand what happened. And so, you know, at the time I didn't think twice about it. But now I realize that he, even when he did a political campaign, he thought about it as a big public pageant that was going to educate people. He knew how to begin the story. You don't know anything about it, I'm going to draw you into the story. These drums are going to play. We're going to have drums in the public housing projects, okay? Then we'll have my speaker from the community on stage. I mean, he's got it all scripted in his head. And he literally thinks about many of these things. I think that artists, contrary to what many people think, that artists are something fluffy on the side, we'll bring them in for some entertainment and stuff like that. I think that thinking more deeply about it, that these artists, and Barack is only one of many, Paul Wilson was one I said earlier, and many others, really have a lot more to bring to the table in terms of how to think about black politics and community organizing than people have thought in the past. And I think that's what Barack, brought to that table there, in addition to other things. And I think the other piece of it was that every time there were political demands, there were always cultural demands. So, they were changing the name of schools and things like that, and they were going to build a Nat Turner School, and it was going to be a Martin Luther King School. You know, but Baraka said, yeah, and also a John Coltrane School of the Arts, right? You're going to rename things and stuff like that. And when I was in SNCC, I was into the whole revolutionary nationalism versus cultural nationalist thing. That was my training. And so I was very skeptical of Baraka in the very beginning. And I went to, I heard, my uncle was involved with Barack. He was going, and my uncle was like a boxer. And suddenly my uncle's saying, you got to come to this play Friday night. I said, a play? You mean a boxing match? Dre said, no, this guy's got these plays. I said, and you're going? Right? So first of all, okay, so it can't be this elitist culture that everyone's talking about. In the, I'm reading the Black Panther newspaper, that there's an elitist cultural nationalism, but my uncle is not elitist. He's going to the boxing mat, so why would he want to go to these plays? And then, so I said, no, sound, you know, these, I'm reading revolutionary, this sounds racist, so I'm not going to that. So then there was a, there's, you know, Sterling Street in Newark is one of the poorest streets in the city. And there's a lot of open lots. So Baraka invites Sun Ra, I don't know if you know about Sun Ra, he writes Sun Ra to play in this open lot. And I go down there just to check it out and see what these cultural nationalists are doing. And the first thing I see, all these homeless people out there. You know, Sun Ra sets up, and he's got like a spaceship kind of momentum going there. And by the time the night hits, and the lights come on, Sun Ra does the thing. You really think we're going in outer space. And I watch these homeless men dancing in that vacant lot. And I said, hey, you know, we've got this all wrong. We've got this all wrong, right? So I did my little investigation. I didn't know where to put it analytically at the time, but I said, he's reaching people we're not reaching. And culture, this culture is not elitist. This is everybody's culture, right? And it's reaching people we've never reached before. So that was my initial take. And then I met people. The other piece was just the membership was grassroots. The membership was largely working class and poor people. And that was not part of, you know, it was being called bourgeois nationalism. So I expected middle class people with ties on when I went to the meetings and stuff like that. You know, you had everything from winos to welfare mother. Everybody was involved in this movement. So over time, finally, when SNCC kind of unraveled in Newark by 1968, a number of us jumped ship. I was the last to jump ship from SNCC in Newark and go toward Baraka. And with all my misgivings about cultural nationalism, I went in there and went along for the ride for a decade or more. I met many people, amazingly talented people. Yeah. Now, in addition to the welfare mothers and the winos and people like that I told you about, there were also one guy, he never told me at the time, he was a math genius. I did economic development, so I knew he was a math genius because I worked on math with him. He tells me now that he was my math teacher for a day. He was like a student teacher when I was in junior high school. I can't remember that. But he was also helped found the whole computer industry with Wang in Boston, and he left a management position in the computer industry to join that movement. And then when it was over, he went back, and he's a computer executive now. So there were all kinds of people. So it was a special moment when talented people from all those different backgrounds came together and sat in circles like this and talked about how to change not only their community, but what effect they could have on the world. And it went everywhere from working in Newark to working on the National Black Assembly at Gary, Indiana in 1972, trying to address what should be the black political thrust in the electoral arena, what should be our ideas about environmental justice, foreign affairs, right? And then they founded the African Liberation Support Committee, which is going to sound ancient to you, but there was not too long ago when millions and millions of Africans, hundreds of millions of Africans were still suffering from colonialism as late as the 70s, okay, when Nixon was the president. And then the African Liberation Support Committee was an American-based kind of group, not just American, but Caribbean, Canada, that lobbied, protested, and pushed the government, the U.S. government, to back off its support for apartheid in South Africa. The Rhodesian government that was now Zimbabwe for white minority rule, and the Portuguese had big colonies in Africa, Angola, Mozambique, Guinea-Bissau, and stuff like that. So when people tell you these movements didn't do anything, that's not true.
That's right.
Right? All those people in Africa are now at least independent. So it didn't matter what we did, right? It didn't matter. We can debate whether black people in inner cities are better off or not, but at least most of those cities are self-governing now. And like Baraka says about Newark, his children grew up without being in the face directly under white racism. Now what you do with that future is up to, you know, many of you in this room knew what you were going to do with that. But at least, so it did make those changes and stuff like that. So without, I think I'll let you, I'll open this up for questions now because I don't want to go too far. But anyway, that's what I came, those are some of the findings I came up with after I did that study of interviewing all those people and stuff like that. I came to respect them a lot more. The sacrifices that they had made, many of them had made in their careers, and the contributions they had made. I'm Komozi, I didn't get a chance to meet you.
I see.
And your field is?
William.
I'm Komozi. William. And your field is?
Sociology.
Ah, okay, that was my, after I got thrown out of the philosophy department as an undergraduate for taking over a building, I majored in sociology. Yeah, I was a bad boy in college. So, do you have any comments or questions you'd like to?
Also, Jacoby.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't meet you.
He's writing on, unfortunately, the Chicago Panthers.
Oh, wow, okay. You know John Rice?
Read his article.
Yeah, he wrote his dissertation on the Panthers, too. And he's still out there. You might want to talk to him. Have you been in touch with him?
No, I haven't contacted him yet.
Oh, yeah, he's still
just
around.
Trying to find as much as I can about what he started in. Chasing his steps at this time.
He's the man that seems to know the most about that. Not too many of them are left. He was a Chicago Panther. Yeah, I mean, what we do after we did this thing in Newark is now, you know, what happened is that there's a whole, when we started this, we didn't really have, there was no field called Black Rebel Studies, okay? I did this based on trying to do the right thing with this particular community of people who wanted their history told. But now it's a phenomenal thing. It's all over the country, different things. And despite all the weird propaganda about the war between cultural nationalism and revolutionary nationalism, we are all in this together. So I was at the Black Panther History Conference last June at Wheelock College in Boston, and we're trying to help the Panthers collect their history. Many of the documents, unfortunately, are still outstanding, which makes it a little bit more difficult, but that has to be done. We're helping RAM is putting their documents out for the first time, a revolutionary action movement. But it's just the golden age of Black nationalism, in my opinion. And this is tens of thousands of stories to be told. We got this young guy, Ronaldo Anderson's just wrote, the new book I'm coming out called Groundwork. And he's looking at the other Midwest Panthers in Des Moines, Iowa, Nebraska, and some other, Lincoln, right, it's phenomenal stuff. And then, you know, you have a chapter founded by a woman in Des Moines.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so it's, you know, I'll send you a copy of it, of his draft if you want. But anyway, so a lot, this new stuff, Scott's work on us organization, is really going to transform the whole interpretation of that period. And it's just beginning to flower. So it's a very exciting period. And I'm very excited to just be part of it. I mean, people talk about me being this, that, and the other thing now. But, you know, in the beginning, we just were trying to write the story down. And we didn't think that the Academy was even going to publish the book. I mean, that was an issue back then. But and John Dittmer, who wrote the Civil Rights Movement, and we're honoring him in this book, Groundwork, forced the university presses to publish the book. Princeton turned the book down, right? And so as late as 91, we were still being censored and the story was not gonna be written. But now Scott can tell you, I mean, people are, you know, jumping to try to publish anything we write, which this is really a different period. Yes, sir.
I was curious, who's your uncle who's the boxer? What's his name?
Yeah, my uncle Honey, yeah. What? He was just honored last Kwanzaa for his leadership.
My great-grandfather is Sugar Ray Robinson. And my grandfather by marriage is Juan Carlos.
You know, it turns out, part of this piece I didn't read in this new book I'm coming out with, is I found out my uncle was involved in anti-McCarthyism. There was a political movement in Newark, independent Black political movement in the 50s that came out against the McCarthyism, okay? And the Golden Glove boxes were part of that. I couldn't figure what the hell these Golden Glove boxes have to do with this. But it turns out that from the 1930s on, there's an anti-fascist, progressive Tennessee among sports clubs in Newark. And the fascists and the in Newark, you know, you have large Italian-American population. And unfortunately, there was a big pro-Mussolini element there. So when Italy invaded Ethiopia, they did a big demonstration in Newark that Ethiopia is Italian, right? And this led to many street fights. And when the Nazis come up, they're beating up Jews and blacks, right? Mm. And so there are Jewish and African-American boxers, sports clubs, that literally fight the Nazis in the street. And that's the background to my uncle being a boxer and being political in the 50s. So I'm going further back now. And it is interesting that it was my uncle's history that made me, what's going on here? Right? Well, you know, what is this story about? So I usually don't do too much family history, but he's the one that got me involved in politics. So, yeah, and he was one of the founders of the United Brothers as well, I should say that.
Now, let me get a question. Talk about this Professor Brown's class. There's always this movement started in 60, then you got 68, these movements are up. But you're saying that there's a long history. Do you think that the hip-hop movement sort of has this birth in the same thing? Because I see a lot of in the hip-hop movement, especially, you know, 80s and early 90s, is the ability to do the same thing that Jones is doing. So teach, tell a story, Lacaris One, You Must Learn, he tells a story through the video. Do you think that because Bakari Katwana, his recent book, Hip Hop Generation, says there's a split. Do you think the hip hop has had this split, or is this just a continuation of the movement?
Well, it's both. It's both, right? I mean, it's a new generation, but they are, you know, the children of the Black Power generation. Mm-hmm. Right? If you look at Baraka's household, it's his son, mm-hmm. Raz Baraka, right? He's hip hop. So, I think that the split is somewhat my generation's fault, mm-hmm. right? I think many people now want to forget their youth, right? All parents do this, right? But, and so I was at a conference where Karenga came out against people who were in gangs and mm-hmm. had been in jail and stuff like that. And I said, well, you were in a gang. You were in jail.
I was in a gang when I was a kid,
right? So I mean, what's the difference, right? So let's not make believe that this is an alien experience. You know, I was beat up by the police when I was 12 years old because they thought I was in a gang, and then the only thing I could do after that was join a gang for protection, right? So all of us were in that. And this guy Dave Barrett, the computer guy I'm telling you about, was in a gang when he was a kid, and he thought there should be peace. So he organized a peace summit between all the gangs and solved the gang problem in Newark, right? So I think I'm trying to get in this, not this book so much as the next book, is try to get people to talk about how they went. Let's start where we really started, because there's more in common, mm-hmm. right? That we started in these youth gangs and we did something with that, right? And instead of saying, okay, you're in a youth gang, so your life is nothing, and you should end up in jail. Matter of fact, the guy who got me out of trouble, the head of we had a big gang, the biggest gang in New York was called the Aztecs. And so after I had this problem, the police beat me up and all that. So I joined the Aztecs, and Purcell Woody was the Duke of Newark, the best boxer, and he was the head of the Aztecs. So I'm in there, like I did, you know, a few things, and I was getting in the group. And Purcell comes and says, what are you doing here? So I said, I'm, you know, joining the gang, right? He said, no, you don't belong here. I said, no, look, I can work my way into this, right? And stuff like that. He said, no. He said, people like you have to do something else. Mm-hmm. We could do this. He said, you're doing well in school. I want you to do something else. I said, well, hey, look, I got a little problem here. You know, if I go one block up, there's another gang. If I go one block, and then the police are over there, right? I need some protection, right? So I want to be in the gang. He said, no, don't you worry about that. You do your studies, and we will protect you. He said, it will never be more than a one-on-one fight. And my father was a boxer, too, I should tell that story. So I knew how to, one-on-one was okay. It was like when I was 12 against one, it was bothering me. So from that point on, every time I had a fight in Newark, the Aztecs regulated it. The Bergen Street Gang tried to beat me up one day, 12 of them. And I beat up the head of the Bergen Street Gang one-on-one, and that was it. But I have to give credit to those people. I wouldn't be here without them. Right? And when my later, we saw Purcell, I had my three sons with me, and he was all beat up, hardly teeth in his mouth and stuff like that. He was a beautiful man at one point. And I said, you know, I want you to meet Purcell Woodard, the man who saved my life. I think we owe to tell a more complicated story about who these young people were then and who they are today. And because otherwise it justifies the police coming down and killing all these kids. And many of those kids, they would have killed me. They would have killed Dave Barry, who's a computer executive. Right? If you just go down and make these massive sweeps, right? So I'm against that. As a matter of fact, part of this particular paper that I'm putting in this new groundwork is about three kids who were gang in a gang who joined a group, and it takes them through their career. They would have called Harold Wilson, they would have called him a gangster at one point in time, right? These people are making important contributions to the thing. But there is the anti-Huey Newton kind of literature, that book, Shadow of the Panther, I think that goes much too far in criminalizing these groups. And unfortunately, a good friend of mine, Gerald Horn's book, I think it goes much too far criminalizing all those groups in L.A. He talks about the Nation of Islam, totally as a criminal group in L.A., the Panthers, totally as a criminal group. And this is going much too far. And like if you read Scott's work, he tells you many of these people have the same social background as the people who were in SNCC, who were Black Panthers, who were in all these other groups. So by singling out any group that was nationalist and somehow criminalizing them, you set up a framework that almost justified all the FBI and police repression that happened there, right? So, you know, we were in gangs, right? But like I talk about these three kids, we went to Princeton University when we were 15 years old. Mm-hmm. Tell the full story. We're complicated people just like everybody else is, right? We got a complicated history. And then we went on and made contributions in the movie. We found Malcolm X when we went to Princeton, of all places. Matter of fact, see, I'm always a bad boy. So I was in detention at Princeton. I used to come to classes late. And so me and Doc Holliday, who's in the story here, they put us in this detention room, and there was a record player, 1965, and some music by some dude named X, as far as we were concerned. We were totally unconscious, right? And we put it on the record player, and we heard Message to the Grassroots for the first time. Whoa, it was music to our ears. And then we went back to the dorm where the other 40 people were and said, hey, we were all wrong about this dude, Malcolm. Listen to what he's really saying. And from that point on, we were all trying to figure out, okay, what group should we be in? We weren't with Malcolm. We should have been there, right? Too dumb to know what was going on. Now what should we do with our lives, right? And even when I went to Andover Prep School in New England, the next year, Malcolm's agenda was there. He said, you know, you have to study history. You should know about the Chinese Revolution. So I took a course on China. Right? So, I mean, he basically gave me my curriculum for the next 4 years, and I did that. So, and all of us were doing that kind of thing, and then we'd come back and compare notes. The thing that Baraka did for us is we were all in one group for a change. There were a lot of smart young people from all over the country coming in there, and we would stay in the library and talk about what does Harold Cruz's book mean, what is Fanon's book, and it was great. It was almost like a university outside of the university. Right, Walter Rodney would come by and give a lecture. Any speaker who was coming would give us a lecture on Tuesday night. So it was in many ways a school, and it was a very exciting period, even for an intellectual like me, to be involved in it at the time. I know it must have been even more so for people who hadn't gone to college and stuff like that. But everybody got the same exposure.
Yes, sir. Dynamics that went on in Baraka, was it the leadership or was it the demographics of the city that the movement started? I mean, what was it? I mean, why did it happen in Houston, Texas, Philadelphia? I mean, was it certain dynamics?
Well, a lot happened in Philly. I'm reading a manuscript on that by Matthew Countryman, and he's talking about Philadelphia. The big It seems like Philadelphia crested earlier than Newark, before Black Power. Philadelphia's leader of the NAACP, this guy Cecil Moore, apparently was like a Robert F. Williams. He was combining self-defense and integration at the same time. And King wanted to come to Philly. He told him he couldn't come. Right? But when their black power happened, Philadelphia is a bigger town, too. When their black power happened, he said that they basically, their movement was decentralized. Our movement, because of these conventions we had, that I didn't talk about, this umbrella structure allowed, and that became the structure for the whole movement, gave it a unity. Even though you had all these different groups, right? It was under this one umbrella. They had their own identity. But once a year, we kind of decided, these are some projects we're going to do together. And one of them was to take power and do certain things like that, right? And so I think the smallness of Newark, that it really is not so big. I'm in New York now. I can't wrap my mind around organizing New York City or Brooklyn. I mean, these are, you know, Newark is, so the smallness, you can still have that fictive community piece there. Right, in a sense, everybody does still know everybody. They've known you since you were in junior. I mean, these are almost everybody I'm talking about here that coming in, they knew each other when they came in. I think Oakland probably is parallel to that. That many of these political groups are coming out of youth association kind of groups. They're neighborhood groups already. And there's I think there's something there that a big city has a harder time with. So I wouldn't be an expert to, I've tried to give advice to people in these big cities, but I really, that would be a bad comparison in some way to do a Newark to a New York, or LA, or Chicago, I guess, right? And Philly also seems to be a much larger scale. Sections of Philly. Sounds like they were being organized a certain way, like North Philly, this, even North Philly is really big, right? So I think scale is one thing. And I think also the fact that the gangs had already peaked and declined in Newark. When I came up, gangs were there, right? So what we did in Newark by 1967 would have been inconceivable in 64, because territories would have been important. So the whole thing that black youth throughout the city should be organized as youth would have been hard to sell, because, hey, what street are you on, right? That was the most important thing for youth in 64. By 67, after that peaks, it's post-gang, right? So the Chicago, I have to give Fred Hampton and people like that props, right? I mean, that's really hard organizing. We didn't do that. I would say Karenga and some of the groups out here, I think some of the organizational structures of those groups is the breakdown gang territory, right? How do you get people to identify? Well, no one talks about the context. They're already identified as gang territories, okay? So this new identity, you are a youth group between 15 and 20, that's really it's kind of a Zulu nation building scheme, right? Not nation building in the big modernization scheme, but how do you bring people together on another denominator and say your age is the thing? Those in that context, those are important things to break down gang loyalties, right? How do you make the loyalty to the community and the politics the most important thing, as opposed to this other identity? And I don't want to talk too badly about that identity, because I was, you know, like I'm saying, it's not totally negative, but if you're going to try to build a political movement that's going to serve people in a whole community, that's the big change Baraka had to make. One of our elders, Baba Mshuri, told Baraka he would work with Baraka and the United Brothers if Baraka stopped all the cursing he was doing. He said, I can't take you to churches if you're going to have that foul mouth, right? I can't take you if you're going to do certain things, right? Or that drinking, you know. So there's a number of things that people had to reform themselves, and the elders telling us that, because, you know, Baba was like grandfather to all of us. They were the only ones that had the authority to, you know, anybody else would have knocked them out if they had said that to us. But Baba had been a gangster when he was young, so you respected that, and that had been reformed. And he was telling you, I want you to stay out of trouble. I'm getting tired of bailing you out. So act right and be revolutionary. So it was a whole redefinition, and Baraka was, you know, part of that. Because I remember Baraka got very angry and threw a chair at this guy in one of our meetings in 1973, and he cursed. And he looked at Baba and apologized, said, "I'm sorry, Baba." I got mad. And then I realized that this, you know, Baraka was supposed to be the leader, but it was much more complicated. There were people he, his elders, he had to respect in those rooms there. And that, so it's a much, it was a unified leadership thing, and Baraka was reformed along with everybody else in that thing. Yeah, doing the research helped me out because Baba was the first person I interviewed, and he worked with Paul Robeson. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that when I was in the movement with him, but when, you know, he said Paul Robeson was his leader when he was a kid. Baba was born in 1898. So you had that old leadership there that was really guiding us, and kind of when we'd get in the moments, you'd always go in the back room with Baba and some other people, and they'd say, "Okay, this is how we're going to proceed." Right? And that was. So all of those, so I think going back to the hip hop thing, the intergenerational thing is very important. Okay, you know, Black Power, yeah. When I interviewed Baba, he said to me, you know, he's an older person, he said, "Well, basically, y'all was a youth movement." Now, as a young person, I didn't think about it that way because, you know, he took that for granted. He said, "Well, you were all young." Right? So, but we had elders. And those elders have not really been talked about as much. And matter of fact, the reason I joined the United Brothers in the end, I had my final choices of groups to make. And about three of us were in the backyard trying to figure out, okay, SNCC is going, what are we going to do? One of the ways we chose United Brothers was they had elders, right? And we thought, we had been in, you know, the only reason I'm not in jail is just luck, okay? A lot of dumb stuff you do when you're young, okay? Even in the movement, we were doing dumb stuff that you can get 20 years for, right? So we thought about it, so okay, maybe we should go with a more stable group of people who have several generations there, and we can learn something, we can contribute something, but we can learn something, and we didn't want the movement to be over like next year. I mean, that was the big danger in 1968, was were we gonna all just collapse? Or, because we understood it was gonna be a long struggle. So what sense did it make to go out running the street, get shot, and then it was over, and then were your children going to be slaves too? So this whole longevity thing started hitting us that we had to somehow figure out some way to fight a protracted struggle, right? We wanted to, we wouldn't get killed. Not that we were afraid, we were totally crazy at the time, but we thought we had a responsibility to do this for a long time, and at least train the next generation who's going to do it. And that's why the African Free School, I'd say 90% of our money was in youth programs. Right? We sat around the table, we looked at the budget, all the money was going into the schools, the nursery. We started kids, you started African Free School nursery when you were 2 weeks old. We had 24-hour, 7-day-a-week nursery, not just for our membership, but for the community. That's another thing that helped us have a wide united front, is that many people were getting basic services from us. So if you had single mothers, we had the only place where you could, you know, at 7 o'clock you pick your kid up at night after you get off work. And we had libraries in there, so every kid, so even people from working class backgrounds, now the kids have gone to graduate from Yale with engineering degrees. So it really leveled things, not to bring things down, but to raise everything up to a common level there. Yes, an African Free School is almost a miraculous thing. It's amazing what came out of that. Sorry, I answered your question kind of wrong. Any other comments or questions? Yes, ma'am.
But given what you said about the importance of intergenerational connection, given like kind of where people are now,
well, like I said, I think our generation had to do some self-criticism about exaggerating the differences between generations. And now I call for an alliance between the Black Power and the hip-hop generations in my book. I think I'm going to be doing a panel about that at this National Hip-Hop Conference in Newark in June. I work with Raz Baraka and, you know, in my teaching, I guess, would be. I think bit by bit, I don't think it's going to be any one big dramatic thing, right? And I think we're getting ready to work with some of these ministers and these initiatives against gang violence and stuff like that. I think, like I said earlier, the most important thing for us to do is to fess up to who we were when we were kids, right? And not create this big, we were in trouble when we were kids, we were confused when we were kids, and we found some identity, purpose, and direction, and I think this generation is going to do the same thing. There was no generation more screwed up than my generation, believe me. I was there. I was part of it, right? So that would make up a whole story about how we got clear in the struggle. That's how we got clear. But we were confused as hell, and probably worse than that in the beginning. And that's the way all young people are. That's just the way it is. So I think that's the important thing, to come in with that kind of attitude and not as if, hey, you know, I was always knew what was up. That's not real. Yes, sir.
One more thing. Do you think that part of the reason why people have been, that there's a split, that because Black Power Generation has been less willing to admit that they hadn't solved all the problems? Because if you watch PBS and you're a kid, you're like, well, civil rights movement, Black Power, society is okay now, it must be my fault. You think that's part of the problem, maybe that the generation hasn't fessed up to the fact that they didn't have, weren't as successful as they, you know, looking back, they like,
yeah, self-criticism is hard, yeah. So that's why I try to do something in the end of the book, the conclusion, about that. But, yeah, that's part of it. Self-criticism is a hard thing to do. And also to do it in an even-handed way. I mean, some people do self-criticism, everything we did was wrong. Mm-hmm. You know, that's not useful. You throw out the baby with the bathwater, right? So some measured, using good judgment to do that criticism is important. Yeah, and largely the history just hasn't been written. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's the piece that's going on. I'm going to have to excuse myself. I've got to run to the washroom. I'm a diabetic, so when you hear the urge, you have to go. I'll be right back.
Well, this is really interesting, because as long as I've known Komozi, I've actually never gotten to hear him just talk autobiographically about the movement. I knew him first through the scholarship. I was trying to figure out, how am I going to write a book on this cultural nationalist group in LA who is pretty much vilified in most literatures that I've seen. And so with his dissertation on Baraka and the context of African people and Sifan, I saw in it, you know, all these possibilities. So I knew him first as a scholar, and only now getting to hear there's a whole other dimension to it. He's one of the few people who are sort of participants in the movement that have also become real historians of the movement as well. Whereas most of the new work on Black Power are people who are, you know, hip-hop generation. So we listen to hip-hop, but we write about Black Power. Though I consider myself sort of in the middle, more funk generation, because I was playing instruments, and that's my grounded in funk, you know. But I don't think that they're antithetical, but that's just because funk is the soundtrack for hip-hop. So I think that another way that the gap is being narrowed is by the scholarship, which is all done by younger scholars, and we're asking the kinds of questions, I think, that are possibly difficult for participant activists. Komozi is a very fascinating scholar in the sense that his having participated in the movement doesn't interfere with his ability to really engage critically with it, which, you know, doesn't often happen, especially when you look at sort of some of the autobiographies of activists that have gotten published in recent years. One issue is, are they actually able to really give you a critical analysis, I think,
I'll give you this advice. It's the elders. Harry Hayward took me, and Baba. Mm-hmm. All these people born in 1898 took me. You know, after the movement was over, we felt like we were failures. I mean, we didn't liberate all Black people. I mean, that was our big thing. We were kids, right? I think we said one oath we had was, we're going to liberate, and we're talking about Africa, too, at the time. We're going to liberate Black people, we're going to die. That's it. If we don't liberate, we wouldn't know it. So the big thing is, okay, I'm alive, and these people are still oppressed, so what's going on? So the old Garveyites took me, you know, I would, you know, be drinking heavily and stuff like that, and this is the 80s, trying to reflect back on what the hell happened. And they said, hey, look, don't be so hard on yourself. We did this earlier, right? We didn't succeed. We passed the baton on to you, and you're going to pass the baton on to the next generation. So I think that gave me some historical perspective, because we were a youth movement, and that's the hardest thing, is to get some perspective on what we were doing in relationship to the whole sweep of things. So I would say work with the elders as much as you can. Now, one problem with that, that, you know, if you look at Baraka's situation, people, a lot of people say, well, why didn't he go to the elders more? And usually it means he didn't come to them. But that generation before him is very much split the way this generation is too. So it's not simply going to your elders, right? It was either the CP versus the Garveyites versus this versus that. So if you went in, you were getting different versions of that history. So what I'm trying to do, and probably not that successful, is talk to this generation of elders now, my generation, and try to get them to put that old knife down from the old days. And I think if you look in our own families, let's say the Panthers, I taught, one thing that helped me out, even after the elders, was teaching the children of movement children. My first class at Sarah Lawrence College had Elridge Cleaver's daughter, Joju Cleaver. We had, I had Wendy Giott, Lawrence Giott's daughter from SNCC. And I said, whoa, I'm getting ready to teach this through this generation. I've got a major responsibility. And what sense would it be for me to divide these children with the worst that their parents did, right? And they had already, if you look at the Cleaver family, the son is a Muslim. Maseo is a Muslim.
Yeah.
But, you know, I remember Joju once studied Karenga's Introduction to Black Studies.
Is that right?
And she did. And so Cleaver is like calling up on the phone, what you got my daughter studying? Stuff like that, right? So we began to do these panels at the Socialist Scholars Conference every year. We started to do these black panels, black leadership panels. Me, Cornel West, I get Baraka on there from the old cultural nationalist thing, Kathleen Cleaver, and have a panel to try to heal those wounds from the 60s. And basically, for our children's sake, right? I mean, most of our families, if you look, the next generation is making those big separations we thought were important in 1964 were gone by 1974. It doesn't make any sense anymore. So we have to be sober, and I think my generation has a responsibility to start doing some self-criticism and making judgments that, I mean, some people in CAP or C-Fund are a little angry at me because they wanted me to write a much more sectarian book. They wanted me to write a much more, we were always right. That's not true. There's a lot of heroic people during that period of time. We learned from what? I joined the movement because of Fannie Lou Hamer. Right? I sat there in class in 1965, I think it was. We're doing social studies, and they talk about how she was tortured. I said, well, whoa, what am I doing? This woman doing torture for me? I'm sitting here on my behind. What am I doing? I said, where can I find SNCC? And I found out that SNCC was in my neighborhood. SNCC had a chapter in Newark. That's why I joined. So, you know, it's all related. I mean, in Newark, we had a particular branch of the movement. And that's what it was, you know, but every city had all these different organizations and chapters, and it was the bulk of all that moving together that made those changes, that knocked those particular walls of that level of white supremacy down during that period of time. Now, more complicated walls have been erected, but it was a mass effort of all those people. And even, there was a guy named Rabbit that would come into our headquarters drunk as a skunk. And, you know, we had a certain amount of decorum in the organization after a while, right? And so Rabbit would come in there and break the decorum. Where's Leroy? We call him Leroy, right? Where's Leroy? And, you know, I'm on security. You know, I'm supposed to be keeping order down there. I said, oh, Rabbit's here again, right? So then, you know, he comes down. So Baraka might be meeting with a diplomat on the second floor. Rabbit's down there. He leaves the meeting with the diplomat and comes down and gives Rabbit some money for his next wine bottle. I said, look, I don't understand this at all. I'm getting rid of one of the elders. What is going on here? How can Rabbit come in here and disrupt this meeting? He said, well, hey, Rabbit was the wino who was a witness that saved Baraka from doing that 10 years in prison, because he witnessed the cops beating him, the whole incident, and testified at the trial. Everybody has a role. You see? Everybody has a role. And when I went back after studying one of those books, I didn't understand that. I would look at, okay, I'm looking for the Wretched of the Earth, Franz Fanon, Mouse, I'm looking for all that, and it shows up as Rabbit and the people with processes and stuff like that. Everybody's playing a role. Yeah, I remember the guy who taught us martial arts came in, respected, and then they had a guest guy came in with a process and do, and everybody had their afro at the time. So I said, who is this Negro coming in here, right? And then he beat my martial arts instructor. I said, okay.
In Wadishi? You beat him in Wadishi?
No, not him. It was another guy we had who was in this thing. But, you know, I mean, so I said, well, you know, let's do some reality check here. It's what you do. It's not what you wear, right? And all that stuff like that. And that we were growing up. We were kids, so it was youthful. You want everything to be in fashion. But everybody played a role. And particularly older people were just so generous of their time. I think back on it now. And if anything, my generation should uphold that tradition. I think right now, you guys have to pay money to get black studies and stuff like that, right? You have to pay tuition, very high tuition sometimes, right? But I was meeting people in the bookstores. Larry Neal I met in Michaud's bookstore. I was looking at the back of Black Fire, and I looked at the picture of him and this guy, Leroy Jones, and I looked at the guy next to me, and that was him. And he mentored me from that point on. I was at an all-white school, there was no black professors, and I would write Larry, and I'd say, Larry, help, what should I be reading? And he'd send me a book list, and then every time he saw me, he'd say, how are you doing? He'd follow up, right? Every time he read poetry in that area. So it was a... it was the generosity, that tradition that black people have, kept me out of trouble. I mean, and I wasn't paying any of these people. No one's being paid for all the time they spent with me, right? I mean, Baba, the elder and stuff like that, to the day he died. So I think now this mentality that people have to pay this tuition, the only way you can get close to these writers is if you're paying and stuff like that, this is totally antithetical to the way I was at a youth conference, and one of the sisters in the movement came up with me and said, to all these young people, I got mine. It's up to you to get yours. I knew she was lying through her teeth because she was just as poor as I was. So I got up there and said, well, look, everybody helped me get mine. And my job is to help you get yours. Right? That's how we came up. And to try to rewrite that story now as if we all did it on our own, I mean, I got to go back to Perso Woody. If you heard my story, I've met about 100 people who are not famous, who mentored me, right? I mean, you know, it was spanking our behinds and everything, but they were mentoring us and making sure, and everyone had this big investment that you would do better than them, and you would continue to remember who you were, and had a great faith that we would, once we got this education, we would use it to come back and help and work with the rest of the community to define these issues and problems. And so when I went, you know, this neighborhood, the R32 neighborhood, the 100 acres, that happened to be the neighborhood I grew up in. And when I was put in charge of that through the struggle, I got to be in charge of that urban renewal project. When I went to the public housing projects and the elders were there, those were the women I used to carry the groceries when I was a kid. So their welcoming me back home and being proud of me was and almost every movement person I talked to, that was the big thing, is being able to walk down the street proudly in your community and knew you were doing the right thing. And that community, I mean, we never got any money for it, but that I don't know whether you know that feeling. That's a tremendous boost to who you are, that you come back home, and even the people used to holler at you when you were a kid, right? Finally, you're doing the right thing. And what was it? It was the Black Revolution we were doing. And they were our supporters. And they would say, hey, I knew Garvey, I knew this. They were, you know, backing you up. They might think, okay, well, you know, maybe you shouldn't have cursed in that meeting or something like that. They would give you a little help. But they would be with you doing that. And I used to get arrested. I was representing that community. We'd have to go to City Hall to demand these houses. And so they would arrest me one block before City Hall and hold me, you know, this is before, it was all illegal, but they would hold me until the meeting, City Hall meeting was over, they'd let me go, right? But what they didn't know is that we had had our community meetings, and all those old women were much more articulate than I was, so they didn't stop anything. They didn't stop anything, and people would dust me off when I got out, I'd tell them what happened and stuff like that. I remember when the cop first took me up there, I said, I thought you were taking me to jail, because they didn't take me to jail. They took me over to City Hall, and they let me look at the meeting through this glass, right? So I said, I thought you were taking me to jail, because I knew where the precinct was. It was two blocks over. I'd been there many times, right? So the guy said, well, don't you know what's going on? I said, no, I don't know what's going on. He said, the mayor wants us to hold you until the meeting's over. They'll let you go after that. I said, okay. But that's how much that police power, that tyranny was. But even in face of that, I guess one of the messages I'm trying to say is we can't use that as an excuse for not doing what we have to do. We have to figure out, first of all, not how to get ourselves killed, and ways of organizing that are not so one-person-centric, that we were, you know, it's a whole movement of people doing it. Everybody has to be on the same page, and we're simply at best representing the people in those communities. But you're doing the work in a way so everyone can get up there and speak for themselves, right? And so I can go back to those communities, and you know, we started that one development. Some other sisters in the next neighborhood have developed 10 times more housing than we developed. And I'm very proud of them. It's a sister named Smith and stuff like that. I mean, they really, so you do it in a way, so, and when we finally got knocked out of the box, when they finally stopped us from building all that we were going to build, we made a secret contract with Pilgrim Baptist Church. 10 years early, we had a legal contract that said, okay, if we ever get in the corner, somebody's going to develop this community. And we're going to get the money from the government to develop this community, one way or the other, okay? And so the contract said that if Kawaita Development got knocked out of box, Pilgrim Baptist Church would do it. And when they were beating us up, and scandalizing us and all the bad names talking about Baraka and stuff like that, and we were taking it, we never told them what was really going to happen. And so Pilgrim Baptist Church developed the rest of that 100 acres of community. And when the groundbreaking happened, I went there with Reverend Jones, who I worked with in the past, and I remember when Mayor Gibson came and cut the ribbon, and Reverend Jones said to me, he said, isn't that amazing how history is written? He opposed us for everything we did. And now today he's taking credit by cutting that ribbon. And he said, we know that we did. And that community had that consciousness that they rebuilt their own community in the middle of all that adversity and stuff like that. And they're continuing that struggle. So that's the long and short of it. Were there some other questions that I missed when I ran out?
No, I was just sort of talking about my interaction with you.
Mm-hmm. I think, yeah, we have to watch out for the kind of tooting our own horn. I think we have to talk about that generation's work together. And it's a big story. I mean, some of the brothers we worked with were in the Caribbean. We worked with the New Jewel Movement before they became took control of the government. I remember the New Jewel Movement was a community group like we were. And it was talked about that way, too. So you're sitting in a room, and some people are going to end up, and you, same thing's going to happen to you. Some people are going to be running a country. Right? Kwame Nkrumah. Nobody thought that Kwame Nkrumah was anybody special when he's sitting in circles with C.R. James. Matter of fact, they thought he was slow and stuff like that. But if you do the work right, that person may be ending up, you on the same page, that person may end up running a country. So in a sense, I guess the bottom line is take life seriously. That the stuff you're doing now does matter. Right? It is preparing the world for it. And you don't know where it's going to go. But all the mistakes you're making will blow up, but all the good things you're doing now, it matters, and those will blow up as well. Thanks for having me. Oh, I didn't get a chance to meet you. Oh, we did meet in the room there. Okay. Oh, yeah.